Hello everyone, welcome to our channel ISC Steno. We're starting the passage at speed of 80 words per minute. Start. Madam Chairman, I am glad that we are having a debate on the European Common Market. I wish that it had taken place earlier. Had Parliament been in session when the Minister of Aviation of the UK visited Delhi, it would have had an opportunity for arming government with its views, thus helping it in formulating the statement, but at any rate indicating to the world at large that Parliament is fully behind the Finance Minister in the statement that he has made. The statement that has been made by the Finance Minister is admirable, both in content and in tone. The problems that face us as a result of the emergence of the common market of Europe cannot be bypassed. Whether we like it or not, the future is with continental economies, and the emergence of the European Common Market of Europe is one of the steps in this direction. No one can deny the stakes that we have in the matter of entry of the United Kingdom into the Common Market of Europe. I have done some research into the actual position of our trade, and I think it would perhaps help the House to estimate the magnitude of the problem that is facing us. We are importing 35% of our imports from Western Europe, including UK. We are exporting about 40% of our goods to this area. We have a large interest in the outcome of UK's entry into the common market and the terms on which she proposes to enter into the common market. In the present circumstances, we cannot visualize what the terms will be, but we know that our stakes are great, and we have already indicated our deep interest in the terms which the UK would be able to negotiate. But having made our standpoint clear, it would be unbecoming of us to do anything else except to be prepared for all eventualities. I want the House to realize that while undoubtedly this is a great challenge, we ought to be prepared and not content ourselves with giving expression to certain views which might give the impression to the outside world that we are in a state of panic to suggest, for instance, that the pattern of our trade should be changed overnight is not realistic. A changeover in trade is no solution. My honorable friend Shri Krishna Reddy pointed out that our balance of payments was most unfavorable with Germany. I know that it has been unfavorable, and while partly this is due to Germany imposing very high tariffs, let us realize that we have had to depend for aid and capital from the developed countries, notably Germany, and as such, our balance of payments is bound to be unfavorable. It has been recommended by my friend that we ought to think of the pattern of trade being changed so that the Eastern European countries might be our main customers. Before us, the advantages of rupee credit and rupee payments are dangled. I only want to sound a note of caution. While it is true that from the point of view of our immediate difficulties, rupee payments offer a solution in the sense of imports not being a current draft on our foreign exchange resources, we ought not to suffer from the delusion that we are getting something from nothing, nor can we think that these rupee payments which are made may not work to our disadvantage. I do not propose to go into this question today, since the issues that merit consideration are different. I hope that Parliament will have an opportunity of discussing the whole scheme of rupee payments on some other occasion, so that we might have an opportunity of weighing the advantages and disadvantages of such rupee payments. No one for a moment objects to diversified pattern of trade, a structure of trade which is not dependent on any particular grouping of nations. We have emphasized to a certain extent this diversified structure of trade. Probably in the future we have to emphasize it even more. But what is the position today? As it is, the terms which can be arranged for UK's entry into the common market are not dependent on that country alone. They are dependent on others as well. This is the position which we face. We should now find out how best we can line with this situation. There is one thing which has to be affirmed on this occasion. I hope Parliament will affirm it, because there is a danger of our overlooking it to the extent that we suffer by the new groupings in Europe. The moral responsibility of those countries to compensate us is all the greater. This would be in conformity with the trend of modern things in a modern welfare state. If an individual derives a benefit and others suffer injury, there is a principle of compensation or reparation that comes into operation in such a case. Stop.